many blessings, and we know that you will continue to pour them down upon us so that we can recognize your awesome works, and we give it all back to you with praise. One of the many blessings here is this opportunity to gather and worship you. You are such an amazing God. Today is another special day. It's Mother's Day. And we know it's a worldly holiday, but you gave us mothers. That was part of your plan for your family, to take care of and nurture families. Some people function as spiritual mothers for us, and we thank you for each person. Each person who served you through their care for children. We lift up this hour of worship, and that all that we do and say will be honor and praiseworthy to you. As you're looking down, we hope you will feel satisfied with our offering. We ask that you give us open hearts and open minds so that we are ready for whatever you want to teach us this day. And we ask that you use this precious. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to all the moms. That was a long scripture passage this morning. And hopefully we can get through that together and understand it more clearly. So let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity right now. We need your help, because without that spiritual guidance, we wouldn't understand this. It would make no sense. And we thank you for your spiritual work here. We anticipate your spiritual work here, and we anticipate seeing you through your word this morning. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Remember the last time your parents spanked you? You remember that? Whack. Do you remember? Some of you probably never grew up with a spanking, but I did. Remember the last time you were spanked? Some of you was probably a long time ago. A few of you, maybe it was more recent, like maybe it's been an hour ago. The reason? Maybe you lied, maybe there was trouble at school, maybe you didn't show respect, whatever the reason. You had to face your parents. You had to face their disappointment. Their expression, their anger, they made it pretty clear. Whatever happened just recently, they said it was unacceptable. And of course we try to say, but, and bicker with them, but nope, turn around. But, mom, turn around. Their decision has already been made. Turn around. What? It's interesting when you look back at those times and what happened, the discipline. And yes, we made excuses, we denied things. But most of the time, mom and dad were right. Would you agree? Young people, you don't have to agree. In front of your parents, you can just inside, you don't have to say it so they can see your expression. But we've learned this through time. Now today, as Christians, you should know that correction and discipline continues still today. The Lord hasn't finished. Mom and dad may have stopped spanking. They may have stopped spanking us, but the Bible says your Father in heaven will continue to discipline us. The good news is he corrects us always in the right way, in the right time, and always with the right intention for the right reasons. It's always good. God is always good. Hebrews chapter 12, just quickly. Chapter 12, verse 6. Really, this was taken from Proverbs chapter 3. The Lord disciplines those he loves. He disciplines because he loves us always. And the next verse in 10, it says, our Father disciplines us here on earth. Our Father on earth disciplines us for a little while. But God disciplines us for our good. What's good there? That we may share our lives in his holiness. So God's discipline, that word, the Greek for that, means his teaching, his training. It's not punishment. The discipline means to teach and to train in Greek. Because he loves us. It's interesting, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 8, the author says, if God does not discipline you, what does that mean? It means you do not belong to him. And that's really interesting. You are not his son or his daughter. It's like the kids in my neighborhood, for example. They're playing around and they're being foolish and it just gets to be too much. And I see this and I'm like, we're done with this. And there's a whole group of kids there. Which kids do I pull out to discipline? I pull out my kids, mine. I take my kids out. The other kids, they're not mine. But I care about my kids. So the point here is what? In this passage, what is the point? The church here in Corinth that we've been studying, talking about the church in Corinth for the last few weeks, they have earned a spanking, so to speak, from Paul. Their errors need correction. Their errors are serious. And God is using Paul's letters like a paddle. And again, it's a long passage in Scripture. And the language is a little bit complicated. But if you sum it all up, Paul's challenging their spiritual growth here. He's challenging the church at Corinth and their spiritual growth. And he's using himself and another leader. They mentioned Apollos in verse 6. He's using them as leaders, as examples. Because what's happening there in Corinth is really distracting them. The church has allowed the culture to influence what they do. The church has allowed sin to come within the church. And we'll see in the next few weeks that Paul begins to really pinpoint what sin they have there and what sin is influencing the church at Corinth. And we'll be discussing that in the next few weeks. Now, if you remember what we've been studying, Paul has already cautioned them that need for a relationship. They're understanding the real important things that matter and how those within the church, the body, how they need to build this church through their lives. Paul challenges them and their faith as servants. They need that attitude of servanthood. And he's not judging his sisters or brothers. He's just saying the impact of living together and having life together. Paul has been cautioning them how you're living now and how you perceive each other and how you get together in small groups with each other, that impacts your life together. It impacts your life for the kingdom as well. So all of those problems that Paul has pinpointed, it shows that they don't really understand true spiritual maturity and that need for humility. They need humility. And Paul is cautioning them. Your attitude all along has not shown humility. You had an attitude of arrogance. And that is your problem. Your arrogance. And if you look at chapter 6 again, chapter 4, verse 6. So again, he says, brothers and sisters, I have used myself and Apollos, that was another leader. The two of them have been examples to help you. You can learn from us meaning of the saying, don't go beyond what is written. Then you won't be proud that you follow one person instead of another. Like always going to one person. Remember in the last 2 weeks we talked about how they got into little cliques and they follow this leader and ignore the other leaders. They follow this leader and ignore the other. And Paul's saying, the reason that you've been struggling, the reason that you're not unified here is because you have become judgmental and because of your arrogance. You are ignoring verse 6 and what is written. You're ignoring the Bible. And for them, that meant the Old Testament, specifically the first 5 books of the Old Testament. You've been ignoring what is written there. And I, Paul is speaking, he says, I follow, the apostles follow. Why would you not follow it? If we're following it, we're following what is written, why aren't you following what is written here? And this, again, includes the Old Testament and New Testament, but Paul is saying the scripture, that is your boundary for life. It's all right here. Your actions, your attitudes, your moral choices, your relationships, it's all right there. So humble yourselves, rely on his teachings, and your life together will be good. It will be. It will thrive. But when you decide, well, I know what the Bible says, I get that, but, you add that but, and that means I know what's best. I know what the Bible says, but I don't care what the Bible says. And that causes chaos within your personal lives, yes, but also within the church family as well. And God's word, the Bible, is like, you know, those guardrails on a highway. Guardrails on the road, you're on the sides. I don't know, it's like a gray color or silver or whatever, but those guardrails on the side of a road. Why are they there? Why do they have those? They keep us on the road. I think I have a picture. And that is not my car, just so you know. Because if we're driving along and we veer off the road, we get distracted and we go off the roadway, we drift. Sometimes we drift. And those rails, when you hit them, they can save your life. And the Bible is the same way. The Bible is just like that. We tend to drift. Our human tendency, sin pulls us away, and we tend to drift. And the boundary is right there. That's the Bible. Oh, and we go back. Get back on path. So if that's true, and we have this wonderful gift, thank you, Lord, for those boundaries to keep us on the straight road. It's wonderful. And why would we, in verse 6, just go along beyond what is written? Meaning, again, I know what's best. We're asking for trouble. We're asking to go off the road there. And I know we assume that we know best. And think about that. We assume that we know better than what God himself has provided for us. And Paul says, whoa, how arrogant is that? Right? Pretty arrogant. Oh, I know know, but, that but, I know what's best. And Paul says, that's arrogance. And you have no right to read verse 7 here. This challenge, who makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? That meaning that all the stuff that you have, someone gave that to you. And if you did receive, why do you brag as though you did not? What makes you better than other people? And that's what Paul's asking them. Talking about you. Have accomplished something for yourself? No, you haven't. God gave you that. He gave you the gospel. God gave you to save you. He gave you his word for growth. He gave you his word for life. Everything that you have, everything that you've accomplished. Look back at everything you've accomplished during your lifetime. God gave it to you. It was a gift of grace. So why is Paul asking them, if that's true, it's all been a gift, why are you boasting? Look at me, look at everything I've done. You should be grateful. You should be joyous because of his grace. What you have earned, it's nothing. You and I have nothing. In verse 7 it says, it should cause us to get down on our knees and ask for forgiveness for our arrogance. Because we tend to live like I am responsible. I have done this. Look what I've done. Our promotion at work, our beautiful home, our children's successes, we're patting ourselves on the back. Good for me. I am great. I've done a great job. And the world out there says, oh my gosh, you are just awesome. You are so good. And we believe it. The reason for all of those things is because of God and God alone. It's his grace alone, and he deserves the thanks. But Paul says here, the church is overlooking that. You've missed that point. You've missed it. Look at verse 8. Now, the English translation here, you might miss the sarcasm. There's a lot of sarcasm in this one. Paul is being sarcastic here. Oh, so you already have everything. Huh. That means you're full of wisdom. Everything's perfect. Wow. Oh, you've already become rich. You've begun to rule as a king. Without us leaders, you yourself have become like a king. Oh, how I wish that you had become king. And then we could become kings and rule with you. It's full of sarcasm. You're rich. Whoa, Paul's saying. Apparently some people within that church thought that they had maxed out on spiritual life. They were full and they knew it. And Paul uses the Greek word here, which is interesting. Filled or full, which meant stuffed. Like you had just eaten and eaten and eaten and you were stuffed. Couldn't take one more bite. Just absolutely full. And that's the word Paul uses here. Whoa, so you are so full, just Spirituality. Wow, good for you. They didn't need more. They had enough. They were already elevated spiritually. They had a special understanding. And the irony here is, if they really were full, meaning if they just were spiritually mature and they had everything they needed, spiritual maturity, that intimacy with the Lord, they would be humble. And they would not be boasting and arrogant. They would be humble. Because life with Jesus means that we understand who we are before the Lord. We understand that He alone is God and we are not. It means that we accept our role and our responsibility with our brothers and sisters. We're not above them or below them. We are all servants. We serve each other. And then Paul warns them, he cautions them. For us, the leaders, watch how we serve. We are servants. And again, they didn't get it. The church did not get it. And sadly today, the same thing. Some people have this spiritual arrogance. Oh, I go to Bible studies at the church. I read my Bible a lot. My prayer life, I am so close to the Lord. I'm just a champ at prayer life. I know a lot about the Bible. I've been studying the Bible for years, and all of those things are great. But, you know, sometimes our actions, our knowledge, they become the problem. They become a barrier. Because we think we know it all. We begin to feel superior. And I'm sure you've met people who love to talk about all those things, how much they know. They love to discuss and argue about little tiny details. Oh, their relationship with Jesus? Look, that's true maturity. Yeah. It's not. Because spiritual maturity is an understanding. First of all, a mature Christian understands that our becoming holy and pursuing holiness never stops. It's continual. Our growth never stops. Our becoming like Jesus, that never stops. And most importantly, our struggle with pride never stops either. It's ongoing. Now, there is good news. One day, we will become full, so to speak. We will be full. Everything God has given us, we can't take one more bite, one more spiritual bite. We can't take it. One day, and that is when we join Jesus Christ in heaven. Then we will be satisfied, and it will be done. But for now, we live humbly. We live hungry, just motivated for holiness. And in addition, Paul says here, we should expect that we will suffer. That is part of our spiritual maturity, meaning that we can expect suffering. If you look at verse 9 through 13 again, Paul says here, I think that God has exhibited us apostles as last of all, like men condemned to die, ready to die, because we have become like a spectacle for the world, to angels and to people to watch. We are fools, he says, for Christ's sake. But you are wise. You see the sarcasm here again? You are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are honored, and we are in disrepute. Even today, we hunger and thirst. We're poorly dressed and buffeted and homeless. We work hard with our own hands. When reviled, we respond with blessing. When persecuted, we endure. When slandered, we respond kindly. We have become the scum of the earth. The garbage, the refuse of all things. And Paul is describing what here? He's talking about Christian life. And I know some of you read that and go, what is that? That is Christian. Christian life means a comfortable home, good friends, a nice place to go on Sunday mornings. Is that what it means? And Paul makes it very clear. He compares the church at Corinth, with himself as an apostle and the other apostles. From the world's perspective, Paul and the apostles in that group, they're persecuted, they're fools, they're weak, they get no respect, they are garbage. Not like garbage, they are garbage. They are scum. You know what I'm talking about when I say scum? Like your bathroom sink? You pull the stopper out of it and you look down what's in there. Sometimes it smells, it's awful. And you clean it out, it's gross. It's filthy, it's sticky, that's scum. And that was Christian life. And Paul says, you, this church, have a total misunderstanding of what Christian life actually means. You're working for Jesus. That's what that's saying there. When you can, what you can expect. And it's not comfortable, I know that. We say, yes, I want to live the Christian life, I want that. Well, that means pursuing holiness, yes, but it also means experiencing what Jesus himself experienced. That's sacrifice. Jesus's experience was one of sacrifice. So life with Jesus is sacrificial, and it will cost you. There will be struggles, overcoming sin, that natural tendency. And it's not about yourself. You say, I won't, and that will cost you. Rejection from the world out there, it'll cost you. Believing in the Bible, believing in God's word for your life, that will cost you. Changing your behavior at home, with your spouse, with your children, that will cost you. Giving your time for brothers and sisters, it will cost you. Believing what the Bible says about sex and morality, about marriage, that will cost you, meaning that you might lose your family, You might lose friends. You might lose your job. You might have legal problems. You might have financial burdens. That's what it means when it says it will cost you. Here in America, yes, it happens. It's happened already. You understand that's selfish. You have to give up things. Quit. Move on. Become soft. Be more flexible. It's not easy. Bending is not easy. Oh, but I don't want to upset people. I don't want to hurt people's feelings. It's not easy to bend. It's not. Everyone has to agree with that, so I better follow that too. That's easy. Sacrifice is hard. It's painful. But that's what life with Jesus requires. It's not a request. He's not making a request. You know, if you don't mind, if you could kind of please to sacrifice a little. Nope. If you want to follow me, you have to sacrifice. Because that's what Jesus himself did. He gave everything. When he died for your sins and my sins, you and I can try to go along with culture. We can try to live in both worlds, a little in this, a little in that. It won't work. I'm telling you, it won't work. We must be willing to let go of everything. Every selfish thought, every selfish action, every idol, meaning whatever takes us away from him and we put before him, that's an idol. Let go of it and accept the cost. Because Jesus demands all. So when we understand that, keep this verse in mind. It makes sense. Because of what I just explained, what Paul just explained, I'm urging you. Urge. Again, it's not, if you don't mind, if you think you might do this, let me know. I am urging you to imitate me, Paul is saying. He's pleading here. Again, verse 14, it says, he's not trying to shame them. As your spiritual father, Paul is saying. Like a spiritual father. We have many people who have taught through the years. Many people that we can follow, but one spiritual father. I want you to get it. I'm urging you, please follow my example. Now, it's important here that Paul is not saying, live like me because I'm so good. Live like me because I am just way beyond you. He's not saying that. Paul is saying here, live like me. Because I follow Jesus. I want you to follow Jesus just like I do. So what the culture out there thinks, don't worry about it. Human praise, pats on the back, forget about it. It's all part of arrogance. It doesn't belong here. Humble yourselves. Become who he has already made you to be. Think about that. Who God has already made you through his Spirit. Become that. Become who you are already. His. realize, Lord, that Paul's instruction here, your words through Paul, for us it's impossible except through your Holy Spirit. What you demand from your followers, your disciples, is like Jesus' apostles asking Jesus, we can't do it on our own. We thank you for your grace, for your forgiveness. We thank you for your spiritual work within our lives. We ask for your continuous help. We want to become your people, as you have already called us to be, as we are your people. We thank you for the privilege that we have here to learn and grow together as a body.